Notice how the mercenaries didn't. They just kind of walked through, like everyone didn't really have a jump. Some just kind of walked through. Like there is that scene at the school. Notice everyone sort of doesn't have a, like, both Blade and Beastman sort of do like a 180 turn. Like they have their weapons out, look around left to right. Like, sure, that's, you know, that's going to help you notice things right off the bat. But it's not really a jump. It's more like a walkthrough.
So would you especially make it dramatic, or would you just do a, like, hey, I've done this before.
Oh, yeah. I would go buy a cape so yeah. I can make it dramatic.
I mean, just fling in with your cape out?
No. So what I would do is have it in front of me, and then as I walk through, fling it behind me. Yeah.
Oh, how about this? I pick you up like you're surfing, and I kind of like do like a 1, 2, 3, then I throw you through it. So I feel like you're flying when you go to the other end.
Yeah, absolutely.
What do you think?
That's what you, yeah.
I mean, you got to enjoy yourself when you're portal jumping.
Well, I mean, unless you're in Time Cop, because then you just get sick.
Yeah, you're right. And then you have a massive ship to take you there, and you just hit a thing on your watch to get back. We used to talk about this for that movie Jumper. Like, if I had to be a jumper, I would do a jump face.
Right, exactly, yeah.
Like, jump face, poof. I don't know. I love Jumper. Yeah. I think that's a guilty pleasure of mine. So this movie for you, is it so bad it's good, or is it good?
It's good. It's a good movie. It's not a bad movie. I don't feel like it's a bad movie. I feel like it's the best fourth world movie that we could ask for.
Is there a lot of people who have a misconception that, like, this, oh, it's just bad, it's good?
I feel like so. I mean, but that's, like, the case with most cult movies, that you want to like something because it's bad. I don't feel like this is bad. I definitely feel like what Langella did, the costume designs, yeah, it definitely has some shortcomings, obviously, with Lundgren's deliveries and things like that. But that's not on, you know, that's not his fault. I don't really think it's his fault when he was really trying. Everyone was really putting an effort. I mean, you had Billy Barty, who was like the go little person at the time, is Tommen Legend. I think he was Brown Tommen Legend, and then he was the High Alwyn in Willow. So he was hitting, like, at the end of his career, he was hitting a lot of these fantasy flicks as being like, yeah, go to, like, I need a dwarf or like a gnome. Oh yeah, this guy.
I loved him in Willow. I love that movie Willow. Oh my goodness.
Yeah, yeah, we can talk about Willow sometime too. I definitely think it's a good movie. I think it's a good fantasy movie. I think it's something I think a lot of fantasy movies now could use, because here's what I hate about fantasy movies now, though. You need like an 8-hour prologue. Like, there's no reason Lord of the Rings needed its prologue. The Thor movie, the first Thor movie had a prologue. It didn't need it. You could have easily have just done what this movie did to set up the world. It's the sorcerer staring out to space, and you get to see a nice matte painting of Castle Grayskull. You don't need to weigh it down with exposition of the world. I feel like Eternia is pretty easy to describe. I feel like the power of Grayskull is pretty easy to describe. It's just, oh, it's the ultimate power, the end. How they actually tied into, like, what the concept of Master of the Universe is, I feel like that's a nice little touch, especially consider that the toy line was originally going to be called the Power Lords. So them, you know, them doing Masters of the Universe had sort of stuck in how it was placed and, yeah, how it's used now. I mean, when I say MOTU and people kind of like, oh, yeah, Master of the Universe, even if you've never seen this movie, you know this movie. And I think that's a lasting sort of legacy that a lot of 80s movies don't have. You can mention Legend and people be like, what? And it's like one of Tom Cruise's first movies. What?
Yeah.
Come on. You've seen this movie.
You just hear Tim Curry from Legend. Like, just, oh, Tim Curry, Devil.
Like Tim Curry is the devil, and they're like, what? You know, and it doesn't always happen, but I feel like Masters is one of those movies that even if you don't know it, you've definitely heard of Frank Langella Skeletor. You've definitely heard, like, oh yeah, I know that's a thing. And I think that's a lasting tribute to what this movie means to not just people like me, but for people who worked on it, like Stout, like Langella, who still considers it his greatest role. When he was doing press for Frank and the Robot, he was asked, you know, hey, I want to talk, you know, this guy with a YouTube channel basically was like, I want to talk to you about the first movie I remember you seeing. And Frank's like, well, how old are you? And he's like, I'm in my 30s. And he's like, oh, it's got to be Masters, right? And he's like, yeah, yeah, yeah. Find this interview, because he's like, How did this movie come about? And, you know, he talked about, you know, I had a grandson and I had to take it. I had to take it. And he did. And he even says in this interview, it's still my favorite role to this date.
Wow.
And I think that's something for someone like Langella, who's Oscar nominated, who has such a rich legacy of like horror films and everything like that. I mean, even Perry White is in Superman Returns, even though he was backup because Hugh Laurie was originally cast and then House took off. But, you know, who's still working. He's not working as much, but you know the name Frank Langella. And for someone to still consider this role of all things on his resume to be his favorite role, you know, might be considered weird, but then you see it. And then you see the limitations he had with the makeup and the mask. But how he was still able to emote and project so much emotion and maliciousness and even in some cases of pettiness. Mm-hmm. You know, when he talks about, I don't want to kill He-Man, that would make him a martyr, saying, no, I want him broken, bleeding at my feet. He wants, like, there's such good lines. It's sort of kind of... I've even said this on panels that I've been in, this about writing, you know, what's the good secret about writing a bad guy? And I was like, watch Frank Langella in Masters of the Universe. And that's sort of my go-to.
Wow.
Cause every time I kind of write a bad guy, I always, it's sort of like my go-to voice. You know, there's some people, for some people, it, you know, Hans Gruber and Alan Rickman playing Sheriff Nottingham, or, you know, whoever, or Darth Vader, but for me, always, it's going to bring Langella as an albino. So.
And I think this movie's, it has the 80s kitsch to it, I guess, but it's very handmade, and it's very practical sets, and it's there's enough personality to it to keep it relevant nowadays. You know,
I think so, especially...
Like, some movies get made and they don't have much personality. And I think there's a lot of those that come out now where they're popular. What?
Avatar?
Yeah. I mean, yeah, just movies like that. Like, it looks beautiful. But at the end of the day, this movie, there's these weird cars in it. There's a weird subplot about two teenagers. This guy wanted to be in a band. There's a synthesizer. There's a bat with giant hair. There's a villain who might be actually pretty, you know, who's really good. It's just a very weird movie, and I think that also helps it stay relevant. And does that make sense? It's a clean movie for kids to watch. I read an article about it. Some lady was talking about how she loved Teela. How Teela said, you know, looks like you need a woman's help, and she's like, I'm a woman at arms.
It needs a woman touch, and then she knocks out like shock troopers, and then she gets down with a smirk, woman at arms. Like, yeah, that's a fun little thing. Yeah.
They read it. They're like, I've never seen that in the 80s. That's what someone said. So, I mean, obviously you watch it now and you're like, oh, it's kind of cheesy, but I guess if you're a kid in the 80s and you see that line, and like this character, she wasn't like, she got jealous at Courtney Cox for a little bit, which was weird. I didn't like that line, but she wasn't like, sexualized or anything. She was just kind of a badass who hopped over shrubs. Yeah.
What was also interesting is there's dialogue repetitions, and I kind of wondered if Gruldor's race, their slurs were worms, because Teela calls him a worm, and then Evil Lyn calls him a worm as well. And I always thought that was really interesting. When they're at Gruldor's lair, she says, you little worm, don't you realize what you've done? And then back at Skeletor's thing, the locksmith, the little worm has another key! And it's like, oh, why do they call this guy a worm? And then you kind of like wonder, like, oh, well, is that like a racial slur for his race?
Oh,
I just like, it seems too much. You wonder sort of almost like, you know, they were limited in what they can say and what they, you know, it's a kid's commercial. It's a toy commercial, essentially. So, yeah, they can't get too nasty. I think the most they got was, you know, the Courtney Cox disgusting leg and He-Man being lashed and Skeletor looking, oh god, he's so good, like how he turns and flicks with each hit of the lash. You don't see it, you see like the first two, and then you see his back and everything. So yeah, you didn't see a lot of that in kids movies in the 80s. Was I mean, we had, you know, everyone talks about, oh, kids movies in the 80s were so great. Not really, for the most part. the ones that resonate still, like Goonies, but no one really talks about the Explorers or Flight of the Navigator or, you know, I consider kids movies of the 80s. They don't really have, I don't want to say lasting power, but I feel like Masters is definitely, it has a lot of lasting power. You know, Stout talked about when he went to the premiere, how when Lundgren got the sword and says, I have the power, like that big dramatic reading, theater went up in applause for like minutes just because they finally got to that moment of him, you know, doing the thing. Which is weird because he's already buff, so what power does he actually have?
He could say more power.
Right, I have more power. So it's weird when you're like, no, well, Skeletor has the power now. What exactly does this sword do? So besides deflect lasers.
And slays Buicks.
And slays Buicks, yeah. So, I mean, aside from that, you know, you get that fan gratification moment twice, because then it's at the end where Julie and Kevin have that little orb and then he sees He-Man with the sword and Grayskull in the background and everything. I don't know. I definitely think it's one of the better kids movies. You know, should I ever have kids, it's definitely going to be like, oh, I like this as a kid. You don't have to like this, but here's, you know, a lot of my movies and stuff. And yeah, I put that up with... What's interesting, have you ever seen it in VHS, on like the VHS box?
No, I have not.
So on the back, there's a blurb, and it's, I can't remember who says it, but it's some radio show. It was a radio show that says it's the Star Wars for the 80s. Mind you, two of the Star Wars movies came out in the 80s. So
Of the mid-80s.
Early 80s. Yeah, early 80s. There you go. But that was that always struck with me because it was sort of like, yeah, I can see why they would say that. But at the same time, why would you say that?
They were looking for anything. Now, I have another question. They said they took it out of theaters after 3 weeks because it wasn't doing well. But yeah. I also heard they didn't have money to keep it in the theater. Like, they went bankrupt, Canon, so then it got pulled.
They didn't have money to keep it in theaters. It was doing really well at the theaters. It was one of those weird instances. You can find charts. You can find charts somehow. But you can and look back. They did not have money for distribution. They had to take it out. Went bankrupt. But look at, now, most movies, like, lose money the first couple weeks. Like, that's just how it works. Because people seeing it, they don't want to see it again. You know, no one's a baller. But go back at this chart. If you can find it, gets more money. It makes more money each week. Like, the first week, it didn't make a lot of money. The second week, it made more. Third week, it made more. But then they had to pull it. But, no, it was actually a really rare instance of it, like, making money. Making more money each week as it progressed. And I always found that was a really interesting sort of situation. But yeah, they did not have money to keep it in theaters. And so you wonder what would have happened.
Yeah, if it just would have kept on bringing.
If they were able to keep it in.
Yeah.
If they were able, even for like, you know, like a month. Even if they were just doing it for like a month. What were they able to? What was the initial budget? Do you know?
I think it got up to 22 million.
Okay.
So it started off at 15. You know what's kind of crazy is, I think of Canon's ways of saving money, they made it more expensive. Because when you have production delays, you have all this stuff sitting there.
Right.
Rental equipment. So, you know, even if you're not paying staff, you're paying your rentals that you have that are just sitting on stage. Or you're paying more time for the studios. So... it's an interesting thing how that goes, right?
Right, yeah. Right. Yeah, especially, like I said, going... I looked it up. It was 22 million, and it only won 17... won. It only... it won this money. Hey, it received 17 million. So, yeah, obviously they lost money. But, again, in Canon's defense... well, defense, they had Superman 4 and Life Force at the same time they had this out.
Oh, brother.
Right. It was one of the last movies ever produced by them because all of those movies bombed. So they were able, you know, they weren't able to even keep them in theaters anyway. But yeah, I was just reading up on the sequel was that He-Man would have returned to Earth and was disguised as a professional quarterback.
What?
The project was abandoned when Cannon would not